Churchill sitting on the dock of the bay. If you didn't know what it was.
That's why somebody was playing with you. Everybody else knew we were lying.
So all those in favor step, they both step forward. Everybody step, both step back.
Yep.
All right. It got good.
Oh, God.
Everybody stand up. Repeat this after me. I did not hear Dr. DeBay just a minute ago. So repeat this after me. These are the two most important hours of my week. Help me to cherish them. I'm here today to worship, not to be entertained. I'm singing to an audience of one to accept my worship of the Lord. Give the Lord a hand clap. One more, ready? Let it get going a little bit. Thank you, God, for this new year, this new start, these new opportunities, these new challenges, these new victories. We thank you, Lord. Help us take advantage of these new opportunities. Give Lord another hand clap. Okay. Keep God good.
All the time.
All the time, God is good. All right, let's go ahead and do our little theme song. We'll be doing it for the next few weeks, and then we're going to go somewhere else, but this is just a good theme song for this year. Ready?
Thank you.
Vicki was going to make some announcement. There she is. She's here. Or either she's just short.
Yeah, I'm just short. I'm just short.
Y'all can sit down for a minute. Y'all sit down so I can see her.
Be nice.
Everybody, all hearts and minds clear? Y'all are looking good, whether you know it or not. How many look in the mirror this morning? Just in case you haven't, I'm telling you, you're looking good. Amen? All right. Now, it's time, everybody, here we go. It's time to receive our offering. So if you put your offering in the back, when you come in, if you have already put it in, then that's okay. But I want you to pick up your hand. If you haven't put it in, then you put it on the way out, put it in your hand now. I want you to hold it up. I want you to say this to me. Ready? I lift my offering to you, let it please you, O Lord. This is my seed, although it leaves my hand, it will never leave my life. You will multiply it. Accept my seed, O Lord. Amen. Now, grant the biblical, brother.
Praise the Lord, saints. Does anyone have an outspoken request this morning? Uplifted hands, special needs, lost loved ones. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we thank you for the time and opportunity we have to come in your house. God, we thank you for what you said in your word, Lord. You said your eyes of the Lord are over the righteous, and his ears are open unto their prayers. Father, as we pray to you this morning, we just ask that you would minister unto each and every request. You heard the needs. You saw the hands, Lord. I just ask you to show yourself strong on behalf of each and every one of these. Let us see it, further believe and depend upon you in all things, and give testimony for what you've done, Father. Now be with us in the remainder of this service this day. Father, let your message touch our hearts, Father, and prepare us, Lord God, this day for what you have in store in the future. Father, we thank you for everything that's said and done. In Christ Jesus' name, the church said.
Everybody stand up. Now look at somebody and tell them again, you're looking good.
You're looking.
I didn't say, but God is looking better.
God is looking better.
Amen. Amen. You got to see with the spiritual eyes, right? I mean, it's just a good thing to keep falling in love with. Amen.
I keep falling in love with you. Thank you.
forward to the rest of this day. God is so awesome. He treats us so good. Let's see if I can get us going here. Let's see here. There we are, kids. Keep it simple, saints. We're still going through. We've got a few more, then we're going to be through. But it's just some things that get us through the year. How many want some things to have to get a good start in the year?
Amen.
You know, a stock boy at a grocery store was asked by an older lady, "Can I buy half a head of lettuce?" He walked back to the manager's office, not realizing that the lady followed him. He said to the manager, "You're not going to believe this, but there's no bag out there that wants to buy a half a head of lettuce." He turned around and saw her standing right behind him. And quickly, he added, "And this fine lady here would like to buy the other half."
Okay.
Okay. Maybe not more funny, but the other half of it was. Come on.
All right.
Amen. God is so good. All the time. Let's all stand in good word of prayer, and we're gonna thank God for what He's about to do. Amen. I'm gonna read the text as we get going, so I won't read it to start with. I'll read it as we get going. Y'all ready? Father, we love you. We praise your name. We thank you for your grace. We thank you for your mercy. We thank you, God, that you're ever alive and always alert and always watching, and nothing takes you by surprise. Nothing takes you by surprise. You're always aware. You're always ready. And Father, you don't have to have a plan B because you already got plan A, and it's going to work no matter what. We thank you for it. And Father, we thank you, Lord, that our lives are enriched because of your watching over us. And our lives are enlightened because of your word. And God, we thank you, God, that this year is going to be a good year for us, no matter what. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Church,
amen.
Now you can be seated. Wait down and tell somebody. I hope you're here after what I'm here after. If you're not here after what I'm here after, you'll be here after I'm gone. So. That's a little bit extra. All right. This is fun. This is going to be fun, believe it or not. Y'all say, I believe it.
I believe it.
The fifth principle of KISS. Heavy on the salt, light on the pepper. Heavy on the salt, light on the pepper. Makes you hungry just thinking about it. Okay. Just a few from last week, and we're trying to tie all this together. Man's inability to communicate is a result of his failure to listen effectively. All right? Our world, if you haven't noticed it, our world is collapsing around us as we talk, as we speak. Our world is actually going out of here. It's not going to be long before Jesus comes back. And communication is all but stopped. All I ever hear is a lot of saber rattling, but I hear very little of people actually listening. I don't hear the Democrats listening to the Republicans. I don't hear Republicans listening to the Democrats. I don't hear the Congress listening to the House. I don't hear the House listening to the Congress. I don't hear people in the cities listening. Nobody's listening. Everybody's talking. And somehow they figure if you're not listening, they can talk louder and get you to listen. And the problem is, the louder you get, the more the ears close. So I just learned, stop. No, you got to communicate. You can't communicate, okay. Because God's going to have to get somewhere in this place. He got to get in it, and then you can communicate. The world needs to listen to God, and that's what this is talking about. Being quick to hear, or swift to hear, means to be swift to hear the word of God, but it also means to be swift to hear the word of man. So, and listen to each other. So, again, everybody should be quick to listen, slow to speak, slow to become angry. And here it goes. This is from last week, and then we get ready to do something. I promise you, it's going to be different. God gave us two ears and one mouth, and that sounds like He wants us to listen twice as much as we talk. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
Amen. But listening is a lot more complicated than it sounds. If listening is done correctly, we talked about it a long time last week, but not this week. If it's done correctly, it brings help and it brings healing. But if it's done incorrectly, it hinders and it hurts. I don't want to be a hindrance to anybody. I want to be a help. Amen. How about you? Alright, here it is. Everybody wants to be heard. Everybody likes to be heard. Speak in such a way that others love to listen to you. But listen in such a way that others love to speak to you. There are certain people, when I speak to them, I already know in my mind, go and get ready because negative is coming. Or whatever they say, whatever they said they're going to do, I already know. Well, maybe they're going to do half of what they say. Or I can't figure out what I'm even talking. So I already know that when I'm talking to certain people, I'm trying to listen. But I already know, so I already prepare myself. Then there's others that I want to make sure when I talk to them that I'm not coming on too strong, because I have ability to do that. It's one of my gifts. You know, is I try not to be too strong or try to come on in a way, you know, that makes sense. So, we got to do this. It's very important. So, everyone wants to be heard, but they also want to be understood. They want to know that they matter. Again, God gave us one mouth and two ears so we would listen twice as much as we speak. And while everyone wants to be heard, not everybody wants to hear. That's the truth. Everybody wants to be heard, but they're not interested in hearing what you got to say. Right? They don't want to listen to understand. So maybe that's the reason why God gave us this scripture here. First, the golden rule. Do unto others as you would have them do unto you. Luke 6:31. And then the 2-for-1 special, which was last week. Dear brother, take note of this. Everybody should be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to become angry. So, brand new, ready? Dear brothers and sisters, take note of this. Everybody should be quick to listen, slow to speak, slow to become angry. Swift to hear. In the Greek, it actually means to have a quick and attentive ear. It means to be a target that when it is sent to you, it can hit the target. You listen to understand, and you have to resist the urge to listen to respond. How many times did somebody start talking to you, and you already had the answer figured out in your head? And instead of listening to understand, you went ahead and responded. How many times did somebody try to talk to you, and before they ever got the words out, you already gave them what you thought? You're not listening to understand, you're listening to respond. So, you got to listen to understand. Now, you know, I heard a guy tell me, he said, tell me more. I said, I can't. I've already told you more than I heard. Yeah. Look, a vacuum cleaner salesman appeared at the door of an old lady's cottage. And without allowing the woman to speak, here's the danger, rushed into the living room, threw a large bag of dirt all over her clean carpet. He said, if this new vacuum doesn't pick up every bit of dirt, then I'll eat all the dirt. The woman, who by this time was losing her patience, said, sir, if I had enough money to buy that thing, I would have paid my electricity bill before they cut it off. Now, what would you prefer, a spoon, a knife, or a fork? You're going to start eating some dirt. So here we go. First, yeah, this is swift to hear. I love this. Be sure to taste your words before you spit them out. I'm going to let them soak for a while. Be sure to taste your words before you spit them out. You see, not only to be quick to hear, but we are to be slow to speak. In the Greek, it's talking about slow to begin speaking, not slow while you're speaking. Slow to begin speaking. Watch this. I love it. You don't always have to have the first word. You don't always have to have the last word. You don't always have to have the loudest word. Sometimes the best thing you can say is, help me understand. Wow. Or just say, okay, and then alone. So now, you have to stop and digest what you hear before you're speaking is what this is talking about. You know, again, an efficiency expert concluded the lecture with a note of caution. You don't want to try these techniques at home. And the guy said, why not? From the back of the audience, guy hollered out, why not? He said, I watched my wife's routine at breakfast for 6 years. Well, for some years, the expert explained. She made lots of trips to the refrigerator, stove, table, cabinets, often carrying one single item at a time. Honey, I suggested, why don't you try carrying several things at once? The person in the audience said at that same time, the expert said, actually, yes. It used to take her 29 minutes to get breakfast ready. Now I do it in 7. Yeah, some of y'all been there. I don't know, I can hear it. Alright. So now, remember, I don't have to have the first word. I don't have to have the last word. I don't have to have the loudest word. Amen. Stop. Think about it. Digest before you start speaking. Now, if the house is on fire, you ain't got to digest. Holler, fire! But we're having a conversation. You may want to stop and think. All right. He that is slow to wrath is of great understanding, but he that has a hasty spirit exalteth folly. So now, I see this. Watch. Find it. Be swift to hear, slow to speak, slow to anger. Slowness to speak up when you're angry. Doesn't mean you can't get angry. But if you start speaking while you're angry and don't give it a chance to think, then you're not going to curb your anger. Instead, you're going to inflame your anger. Psalm 4:4 says, don't sin by letting anger control you. Think about it overnight. And remain silent. When your temper takes over, your brain ceases to function properly. Did you know that? When your temper, I didn't say just a small anger, just a little discouraged. I'm talking about now you've let it get out of control. The little spark now is a big old fire. When your temper takes over, your brain ceases to function. Every Monday when I do the guys in B5, I'll ask somebody, who's here because you lost your temper? Every time I ask that question, 75% of the people raise their hand. Sometimes I get 100%, but never under 75. Or when they're in B5, I tell them, this is a privilege to be here, but if you lose your temper and you strike someone, you're gone. A couple weeks ago, went in there was 12. Come back next week, there was 5. Of course, a couple got released. I said, where's everybody else? And they said, we don't know. All those privileges taken away because of temper got in the way. When your temper strikes up, let me tell you something. If you ever got mad and all of a sudden you started breathing it and you felt your heart beating hard, when you lose your temper and your pulse gets over 100, God designed this in every mammal. Of course, the pulse rate may be different depending on the size of the animal. But when you go over 100, every person in this room, once your pulse goes over 100, especially when you're either in a situation where you feel threatened or a situation where you're angry, and usually when the temper takes over, believe it or not, you're feeling threatened. You're feeling threatened because you feel like your opinion doesn't count, or you feel like whatever they're doing doesn't work out, and you're tired of trying to discuss it. You're not being swift to listen, but instead you're just letting it rip. Once your pulse goes over 100, the frontal lobe, where you think, or most of us, think. The thinking is transferred to the back of your brain. And you go into autopilot. You go into the fight, flight, freeze, or fall mode. And once you go in that mode, usually when you've lost your temper, it's usually fight. Some people lose their temper and they run and they go in the flight. Some people lose their temper and they just can't even talk. They've gone into freeze. Others just say, whatever. That's fine. Well, once that happens, your conversation is over. Nothing works. Nobody wins. everybody loses. So it's important that when you're talking with somebody, no matter how rough, how bad, whatever it may be, you better be slow to speak, and you better be slow to anger. Because once that anger gets you, you'll start making some stupid, and I do say stupid, I'm trying to think of a religious word for it, but stupid fits better. You make some stupid, on-the-spot decisions. Once this happens to you, once it gets back there, do you know it takes 24 to 48 hours for it to come back up here? Why? That's why they tell you we've had an accident. Or when you got in a car wreck and you're in the emergency room, to say, now make sure you don't sign any papers and don't make any big decisions for the next 24 to 48 hours. Why? Because you're thrown back here in the fight or flight mode. And then back here, you're not making sound decisions. It's also about it to protect you. It keeps you out of the way because you can't move fast enough and think fast enough when the car's coming. It's a good thing because now you've gone back in there and it's doing things that you couldn't do on your own that fast. But when you're in an argument, it's not good. You're in a bad situation, somebody's pulling a gun or something like that, that's a good thing. But when you're in a discussion with somebody and you go into fight, flight, freeze, or fall, everybody loses. Somebody say everybody loses.
Everybody loses.
That's why James and David said, don't let anger get the best of you. Paul said, don't be angry, but sin not. Don't let the sun go down upon your wrath, your temper. There's a difference in being angry and letting your temper go. It's two entirely different things. Anger is productive. Anger can make you do some things that need to be done. You protect somebody, whatever. But when you lose your temper, you've lost control. So now, remember that. When you lose content, you lose your temper, you lose control. So now, I'm getting ready to end. Ready? I love this. He that is slow to anger is better than the violent. Let me before I can actually read this. I know not everybody has that problem with their eyes, do they? He that is slow to anger is better than the mighty, and he that rules his spirit than he that takes a city. Proverbs 16 and 32. Let's just go, let's look at that a little bit. Of course, I just read that. New American Standard. He that is slow to anger is better than the mighty. He that rules the spirit than he that captures the city. Another version, the NLT. Better be patient than powerful. Whoa. Matter of fact, when you're patient, you are powerful. Did you know that? When I was younger, I thought by my pride, I've seen other people in my family and other people around, they had to get up and be heard, they had to talk, and they had to get right now. But the older I got, you can tell a mark of a mature person. Because really, one of the biggest marks of a mature person is patience. It's a big one. Are you going to do something? Sure. When God tells me. Now, if there are little kids out there in the road and cars coming, I'm going to go out there and jump and grab that kid. I ain't got time to stop and say anything to anybody. But I remember one time, my father-in-law, my first father-in-law, he's deceased too, but DC was a little bit, he's just a couple years old. I had a car that had an automatic or a manual transmission in it. I had the keys in it. Oil in the house, and my father-in-law, he was in such pain, I was focused on him because his teeth were killing me. He was going, oh, and I said, what can I do for you? And I didn't hear the door shut behind me. Little DC had walked outside and got in my car. He's always a big boy. He got in there. I'm looking, and all of a sudden my father's going, oh, and I said, can I help you, brother? What can I do? And he jumps up with his eyes that big and runs past me, pushes me down, and runs out the door and said, man, he must be hurting. DC had gotten in my car and turned the switch, and it was in gear, and it was going across the yard. So he didn't have time to stop and talk. He was in pain. He had to go out and take. And I thank God that he did. Amen. But this is how who he took out on the other side. Moderation. The message says moderation is better than muscle. Self-control better than political power. Think about what I just told you. If you lose your temper, you lose control. I remember back in the early days, before Jesus found me, I remember I'd lose my temper and I'd break something. And I look at the person I was mad at and say, "See what you made me do?" I don't know if y'all ever done that. I don't do that anymore. If I break something, which I don't, when I'm mad, I don't break anything, but I'm angry anymore. But I learned they didn't make me do that. I did that on my own. When somebody tells me that now, "See what you made me do?" Oh God, I didn't do that. I didn't do it. You lost control. You did that. So, with all that thought in mind, let's move on to something sweeter. Y'all ready for something sweeter?
As the days go by.
Y'all ready for some sweet stuff? Of course, it's not sweet as salt. There's a difference. Your words should always be with grace, as seasoned with salt. How are we going to keep from getting angry? How are we going to keep losing control? How are we going to be able to respond to each other? Husbands, if you learn this, your wives will thank you every day. Wives, if you learn this, your husbands will thank you every day. If you learn this, your children will thank you. Your co-workers will thank you. Church members will thank you. But the biggest person who will thank you is you, as you can thank God for learning this. Your words should be always with grace, as if it were seasoned with salt. And be aware of how it is appropriate for you to answer just certain people. Is that what it says?
All right.
What does it say?
Everybody.
Each man, every man. So now, let's just look a little bit. Colossians 4 and 5, New American Standard. Let your speech be always be with grace, seasoned as it were with salt, so that you may know how you should respond to each other. As a matter of fact, the whole thing just takes my words and I'm spitting out when it's seasoned with salt. Remember this. If you taste your words before you, this is a good principle. If you taste your words before you spit them out, and they don't taste good, don't spit them. And if it don't taste good to you, I know good well, it's not going to taste good to the person you're giving them to. The message, I love this one. Be gracious in your speech. The goal is to bring out the best in others in conversation, not to put them down, not to cut them out. The Amplified Version. Let your speech at all times be gracious, pleasant, and winsome. Season as it were with salt, so that you may never be at a loss to know how you ought to answer anyone who puts a question to you. See, an angel got his wings. Where'd that go? Did y'all hear the thing? I thought I had the last verse of it. Then I said, "An angel got his wings." Ready? Here we go. Jesus said, "You are the salt of the earth. You are the light of the world." Matthew 5, 13 and 14. We're salt and light. One of the big things around nowadays, how many see those salt lights that everybody wants to put in their house because it helps purify the air and it's going to be good for you? We had a salt light in our house and it's purted and it's just a light inside of a salt bar or whatever it is, some Himalayan salt. And it's pretty cool. And it just smells good. It really does smell good. I like that thing. Well, Jesus had a better idea. Not by one put in your house. You be the one in your house. You be the one at your job. You be the one. I remember one time,
I was at Fountain. Daniel called me. He was upset. He was working in service and warranty. He was working in welding, the weld shop. Daniel called me and he said, "Daddy, the supervisor just told me that what I just did was sorry. Whatever job he had done." He said, "You're sorry." He said, "You're never going to amount to anything." I got so mad. I said, "I'll be right there." And nobody ever seen this in me. Nobody. Slammed down my phone and I said, "I don't know who that supervisor thinks he is, but he's getting ready to find out who Daddy Bear is." And one of the engineers behind me said, "Whoa there, Home Slice, calm down. So I've worked with you for years. I've never seen you like this, ever. And we've been through some rough stuff. What's going on?" And I told them what had happened. They said, "You normally would go down there and try to figure out what's going on and work it through, make everybody kiss and get better. But now you going out here like you, Mr. Potato Head, lost your mind." And that calmed me right down. I said, "You're right. I don't want to be Mr. Potato Head." So I took a deep breath and I waited. And I said, "God, unless I can be salt and light, I don't want to go down there." So it took a while. I prayed through. I went down there to find out what's going on. And what was going on was both of them were having a bad day. They just have to have a bad day apart from each other. When they got together, two bad days put together makes a big, bad, bad, bad day. And then they were apologizing, kissing and made up once I got a chance to calm down with myself. Because I said, "God, let me be salt, let me be light." So now, why did Jesus call us the salt of the earth? Let me tell you something about salt. Salt is one of the most important minerals in the world. Animals, livestock owners, they have to have salt. People that are farmers have to have salt because salt preserves food. Salt brings out flavor. Salt will soothe and heal. Salt is necessary for life. Salt is valuable. Do you know that Roman soldiers were paid in salt? Can you imagine going back in that truck? Where are you going? It's payday. You're back in that truck. Put it in. Do you notice where the word salary comes from? It's salt. But if somebody's worth their weight in salt, that's like saying they're worth their weight in gold. That's how important salt is. Our words should add value to others and challenge them to be better. We live in a day where everybody's offended over everything. You can't even hardly speak anymore without offending somebody in the room. And anger is so powerful, so present. I was trying to get to the hospital or somewhere, to jail somewhere. I was trying to get somewhere, funeral home. And I got in my car and Linda says, "Watch out." Oh, she always says this. "You watch out for the crazy people on the road." And I say, every time I look in the rearview mirror, I see one of them rascals. I get on the road and I had the right of way. And I start to pull out, and here comes somebody who won't pay attention to us, been texting them on the driver or whatever. I was running. Oh, praise God. So I go a little further down the road, and the light changed. It was green. There was no turn signals. There was no left turn, right turn. It was straight. You waited to turn. And while I'm getting ready to pull forward, the person turns right in front of me. I just slammed on the brakes and said, "Praise God for that." I go down to the next block or two. And as I'm getting ready to come up, somebody just darted from a parking lot. They saw me coming. I was going to 35, full speed of the road. He sees me, runs out without stopping, and pulls out in front of me and toots his horn at me. But then the next day, I got a couple of California Howdies. If you've seen the Beverly Hills Movies, you know what a California Howdy is. And I read a few lips that I weren't too happy with. Everybody's so angry. If there's ever been a time. Matter of fact, the other day when I got the California Howdy, I got the son got the California Howdy to look on him. And I said, Lord, let me be salt. Let me be light. The crazy thing is, when somebody does something to you, and you feel it jump in your heart, and chest, here comes the fight or flight trying to take over. When you feel that, remember, whenever you're in a situation, you feel that, fight or flight's going to take over. It's your decision if it takes over. Because when you feel that, you need to sit down, say, I'm not going there. And do a little counter exercise, breathe, and go, I'm not going there, I'm not going there, I'm not going there. God, let me be salt and light. God, let me be salt and light. God, let me be salt and light. You see, there are three ways to love. Be quick to listen, be slow to speak, and be slow to anger. Look at how that comes in. Watch the shape. What's that shape of?
Cross.
Be different. In an age gone crazy. In an age of outrage. Everybody stand. Randy, come here, play some song. Everybody, head bowed, eye closed. We live in a day like no other. I don't think there's ever been a day like today. I really don't. You don't know where to go. You don't know who to talk with about certain things. You don't know how to handle certain things because somebody's got their feelings on their sleeve, and you can't even talk how you want to talk because you're scared you're going to offend somebody. You don't know who's going to be dependable, who's not going to be dependable. You just... I'll be out doing something in the yard or doing something somewhere, and it's a two-man job, and Linda will say, why are you doing this by yourself? And I told him every time, because I'm the only one that I know of at this moment, only always, but at this moment, I'm the only one available that I can depend on. I mean, my boys will help me when they don't need help. If they're working or Daniel had surgery, you couldn't get Daniel when he had surgery. You know, and I got, you got all these, I know, but at this moment, I'm the only one I can depend on. And something I have discovered as time goes by, this moment that I'm talking about happens more and more and more. Be salt and be light. If you're the only one, be salt and be light. God's got you. You're going to make him proud. You're going to make him happy. You didn't see you being salt and being light. It's been a long said, you got them crazy eyes. Because I figured out those crazy eyes were an indication that my thought patterns are going from the front of my head to the back of my head, and I'm getting ready to lose control, and I'm going to do something stupid. When I was coming up, I had a lot of broken stuff, and I had walls, and in my house, there was walls that had disc prints, and there was appliances because the door shut too fast. There was fist prints in the door, and I hit my head because I was taller than the door, and so I hit it. Stupid mess, but I let the crazy eyes get the best of me. Not anymore. You can't. In this crazy age we live in, crazy eyes have to go. Salt and light. You don't have to absolutely win every argument to win. Every guy closed. Let me ask a few questions. First, is everybody here, anybody here would say, you know, God, I'm really not where I should be with you. And I know that makes everything more complicated. You know what it's like to go into the fight flight, freeze or fall mode, and be there for days, and didn't understand why. I just told you. When somebody tells you, there's those crazy eyes. Usually when the crazy eyes come, then you start breathing heavy. Your pulse goes up. Bad things happen. Ask the guys at Big Five. Ask the guys at Pitt Detention Center. Not everybody at Pitt Detention Center is some guy on the street trying to hustle everybody. Some of those guys are good fathers, businessmen. Making a big contribution in the community, but they let the crazy eyes get the best of them. And they did something that they're not only regretting that after they did, but they regret it now because they're full of time for it. Some of us may never go to a detention center, but I can promise you some of us are still full of time for it. Maybe not where everybody else can see it, but you're pulling time inside your own spirit, time inside your own mind, time inside your own relationship with somebody. And God has so much for you. Like I said, I like our little salt lamp. I think it's awesome. God wants me to be a salt man. He wants you to be a salt man. Something special will happen when you do that. If you're here right now, nobody looking around, every eye closed. If these last two messages, you've seen something inside yourself, not somebody else, inside yourself. Time to be honest, inside yourself that you don't like or you need to work on. Nobody's going to see you. Everybody's bowing their head, not looking around. But you want to work on it. You usually need me to pray with you right now. I know I'm not making you an example, but pray with you. You stick your hand and put it back down. And so I just need some work on some of this stuff, and I really need your help. God, and Pastor, will you pray for me? When nobody's looking around, just lift their hand quickly. Bless them, Lord. Bless them. Bless them. Bless them. Bless them. All right, let's pray together. Father, I love you.
I love you.
I thank you.
I thank you.
As you take care of us.
You take care of us.
Even when we don't deserve it, you still give us your best. And Father, you are the best listener. And you are slow to wrath. And I thank you for that, God. Ask you right now, Lord, to help me to be like you.
Help me
to be a salt man. In a world gone crazy. I trust you, God. And I believe that you're doing something special as we speak. Ask me right now to help me more than ever to be what you called me to be. In the name of Jesus we pray. And church said,
amen.
Amen, amen, amen. We're going to a dismissive prayer, and then John, you're coming up, right?
Yep.
Okay. We're going to dismiss in prayer. And after dismiss in prayer, all that we'll stay, because John's going to show you what's going on in Japan, besides the Japanese takeout. Those things are awesome. Dinner and a show. Amen. And it's always fun to go to the wrong Daniel. He said, what's your name? What's your name? What's your name? And Daniel said, Daniel. Go, oh, Daniel's son. So every time we go, Daniel came to pull up. Daniel's son. Come here, Daniel's son. Let's go. I'm getting you. I just want to chase squirrels. Ready? I said, Lord's Prayer. And I'm going to ask Doug to dismiss us for prayer. And then, John, you come on up. Our Father, who art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come.
Thy will be done.
On earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive our those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
Amen.
Our Father in heaven, thank you for this day. Thank you for this time that you brought us together to worship you in spirit and truth. Lord, we thank you for the message this day. Lord, I pray that we go forth. Be the salt, the light that you call us to be. Lord, be with us now, be with our loved ones, be with those that are not able to be here today. I pray that you would lift them up. Jesus Christ, amen.